Running is one of the simplest forms of exercise. All you really need is a pair of shoes and you're ready to go. But how to choose running shoes can actually seem pretty complicated, especially when you scroll through an online retailer's site or page through a magazine, only to be met with confusing terms like neutral, zero drop, and carbon plate, all of which we'll explain shortly, by the way. This terminology can make you feel like you need a physics degree to simply buy a pair of running shoes. That leaves many people who are looking to run right now, provided they are able to exercise outdoors safely. That means adhering to social distancing recommendations or have access to a home treadmill, confused about what exactly they should be wearing on their feet. Unfortunately, the science just isn't there to uniformly recommend one feature or type of shoe. Assertions that one shoe works best for all runners, or that any particular type will magically prevent you from getting hurt, aren't exactly accurate. Max Paquet, PhD, a biomechanist and associate professor at the University of Memphis, tells Self. It's more likely that increasing your mileage too quickly matters more in predicting whether or not you'll get injured. But don't throw on an old pair of Chucks. We see you, Brittany of Brittany Runs a Marathon, and head out the door just yet. While there's no single right running shoe, wearing shoes specifically designed for running, and the pounding that comes with it, rather than all-purpose cross-training shoes, still makes a lot of sense, says Jeffrey Gray, DPT, a physical therapist and the founder and president of Helux, a company that researches things like comfort, fit, and function for shoe companies. That's because they contain features that keep you comfortable, which some scientists believe is the most important consideration in keeping you healthy on the road. In an influential paper published in the British Journal of Sports Medicine in 2015, biomechanist and shoe expert Ben O'Nigg, PhD, suggested runners choose shoes based on something called the comfort filter. How well a shoe feels may be just as good an indication of whether it'll cause you problems in the long term than any sophisticated lab testing, he proposed. But in order to figure out the features that matter for comfort, it can be helpful to familiarize yourself with some of that shoe terminology. If you're wondering how to choose running shoes that work for you, learning about these factors and features just might help you find the best fit. If you're running pain-free, you may not need stability shoes. Motion control or stability shoes prevent your foot from pronating, a natural movement that occurs when you move forward and your ankle rolls inward and the arch of your foot flattens. Everyone pronates, but in some people the effect is more pronounced, and earlier evidence suggested this overpronation could be linked to running injuries like shin splints and runner's knee, says Paquette. As a result, companies begin designing shoes to correct this, installing plastic posts or denser foam into the shoe to correct this motion, Paquette says. Thus, the stability, or motion control, shoe was born, as was the term neutral shoes, to identify those that lack these stiff pieces and allow your foot to move more naturally. The problem is, when runners began wearing motion control shoes, overall injury rates didn't change that much, as Nigg points out. And when scientists did follow-up research, measuring biomechanical factors like pronation and then watching to see which runners got hurt, the results were all over the place. Some studies showed a link between pronation and injury risk, others none, and at least one study even suggested overpronation might actually protect against injuries, Paquette says. Watch. Figure skaters try to keep up with hockey players more self videos. Most popular. A 5-move dumbbell workout to fire up your legs and butt. By Krista Scaba. Easy lunch ideas, peach, prosciutto, and avocado sandwich. 30 easy lunch ideas you can whip up in no time. By Carolyn L. Todd. The 4-minute, no equipment cardio workout that will break up your day. By Jenny McCoy. Advertisement. While science is not exactly clear on the benefit of correcting overpronation with running shoes, that doesn't necessarily mean you should skip them. Stability shoes are often more comfortable for newer runners, whose stride tends to be less controlled, says Allison Bowersick, PhD, an exercise physiologist and co-owner of Runabout Sports, a shoe store in Roanoke, Virginia. In that case, it might feel better to have your foot locked into a specific pattern. And if you already have some type of pain or injury to the tendons in your ankle, stable shoes might decrease your symptoms, Paquette points out. A healthcare provider can advise you. Cushioning affects comfort, but that magic amount is individualized. Cushy foam in the midsole of your shoe, the part between the fabric uppers and the rubber sole, cradles your foot and absorbs the force of the impact generated each time it hits the ground. Different brands and models use different types of foam and also vary its positioning. This is one of the most critical factors when it comes to how shoes feel, according to Gray. Most shoes use ethyl vinyl acetate, or EVA, which is lightweight, durable, and easy to mold and shape. Some sneakers, like Adidas Boost, use blown thermoplastic polyurethane, TPU, which is also lightweight and bounces back quicker, Gray says. However, it's often more expensive to manufacture, a cost that's usually passed on to the buyer, and it might not last as long. One type of foam is not any better than the other. Again, you should be picking the kind that feels the most comfortable to you. But that doesn't mean you should always choose shoes that feel pillowy soft the moment you lace them up, Gray says. Make sure you run for a minute or two in the shoes. Many retailers now have extended return periods, so you can ship a pair back if it does not feel right for you. Another reason you don't want to go gangbusters on the cushioning is that it affects the weight of the shoe. The more foam you have, the heavier your shoe, and the more energy it takes to move it through the air with each step, exercise physiologist Kyle Barnes, PhD, a researcher at Grand Valley State University, tells Self. That reduces something called your running economy and can make every effort feel harder, in addition to slowing you down. So you want to find the sweet spot for you, a shoe that has enough cushioning to make your foot feel insulated from impact, but not enough that it's packing on extra weight to do so. This will likely differ for each runner. You can use prior shoes you liked as jumping-off points, especially now, since buying online without lacing up in store is your only option. Some brands, like Hoka One One, are generally known for being more cushioned, and are often called maximalist shoes, while others, like On, are known for being lighter, called minimalist shoes, Bowerstock says. If you know you've felt comfortable in high cushion shoes in the past, you may want to stick with that type of shoe, and the type of foam that they use. On the flip side, if you wore TPU and felt like your shoes broke down faster than you'd like, you might want to try EVA foam the next time. The drop might also matter, especially if you have pain in your calves or ankles. The total amount of cushioning is one thing, but shoes also differ in their drop, or the difference between the amount of foam under your heel and that under your toe, which is measured in millimeters. Most popular. A 5-move dumbbell workout to fire up your legs and butt. By Krista Scaba. Easy lunch ideas, peach, prosciutto, and avocado sandwich. 30 easy lunch ideas you can whip up in no time. By Carolyn L. Todd. The 4-minute, no equipment cardio workout that will break up your day. By Jenny McCoy. Advertisement. The higher you go in terms of drop, the more you're basically wearing a running shoe version of a high heel, Bowersick says. The average shoe has a 10 to 12 millimeter or higher drop, while more minimalist models have less or are even often zero drop, or completely flat. Although zero drop shoes more accurately match the position of bare feet on the ground, transitioning to them too quickly can raise your risk of injury, Barnes says, likely because it stresses different muscles in your feet and legs than regular running shoes do. And if you're prone to Achilles problems, a higher drop can take some of the pressure off your heel and calf, reducing your symptoms. In fact, it's similar to a treatment physical therapists recommend, sticking a foam pad under your heel. If you don't have pain or a history of Achilles injuries, drop may be merely a matter of preference. If you tend to strike the ground with your heel first, a gait pattern common in newer runners, having a higher drop, and hence more foam under your heel, may feel better, Bowersick says. However, since there's some evidence linking heel striking to injury, you might want to revisit that later on if you do develop pain in your legs or feet. Carbon fiber plates can make you faster, at a cost. If you've been a regular racer itching for PRs, you've probably been following the controversy over carbon plate fiber shoes like the Nike Vaporfly 4%, $250, Nike.com, and Next%, $250, Nike.com. Nearly all recent record-breaking performances in the running world, including Eliud Kipchoge's sub-2-hour marathon, have been set in them. Other shoe companies also have models with carbon fiber plates, like Hoka One One's Carbon X, $180, HokaOneOne.com. In both Nike-funded and independent studies, including one that Barnes performed, the Vaporfly shoes have been shown to reduce the amount of energy you need to run by an average of 4% or more, which then translates into faster race times. The secret to how they work, Barnes says, has to do with the combination of foam and a thin, curved, carbon fiber plate embedded within it. The plate acts like a lever against the ground, propelling you forward with less effort. Think of it as using a wrench versus your fingers to unscrew a bolt, Paquette says. It also stabilizes the shoe, allowing manufacturers like Nike to pack more lightweight foam around it with less jiggling or side-to-side motion. That foam is extra compliant, scientific speak for squishy, as well as resilient, or able to bounce back to its initial shape quickly. That means you lose less energy each time your foot hits the ground. And as one study from the University of Colorado showed, your calf and foot muscles don't have to work as hard with each step. That's probably one reason runners often report that they feel less sore and are able to bounce back more quickly after a race or a hard workout when they're wearing these shoes, Paquette says. While some have suggested the technology only works for superfast runners, two New York Times analyses of Strava data and, Barnes says, a study he's completed but not yet published, suggest otherwise. I've never measured a runner who didn't show benefit running in the Vaporfly, he says. However, he says, they do represent a deviation from the idea of comfort. The foam is stacked so high many runners report feeling a bit unstable or gangly. And for the price, you could buy two pairs of most other models and rotate them, Boersick says, a strategy that's been shown to reduce injury risk. The design of the uppers can make or break you in the blister department. In recent years, manufacturers have increasingly realized that what's on top matters in the feel of a shoe too, Gray says. Now many use stretchy knit and woven fabrics with less stitching, some, like the Adidas Solar Boost, $160, Zappos.com, or Brooks Launch, $100, Zappos.com, are even all one piece. As a result, they weigh less, hug your foot more snugly, and are less likely to rub your skin raw or cause blisters, Barnes says. Most popular. A 5-move dumbbell workout to fire up your legs and butt. By Krista Scaba. Easy lunch ideas, peach, prosciutto, and avocado sandwich. 30 easy lunch ideas you can whip up in no time. By Carolyn L. Todd. The 4-minute, no equipment cardio workout that will break up your day. By Jenny McCoy. Advertisement lacing systems have also undergone an upgrade. Instead of a classic laces run through metal-rimmed eyelets, newer models often feature cable or speed laces, which are stretchy, adjust via a pull cord system, or are otherwise easier to use or more customizable, and the better a shoe fits, the more comfortable it's likely to be, Gray says. For an example, check out the On Cloud, $130, Zappos.com. Again, there's no one upper type or lacing system that works best for everyone, it's more about trying to see what works best for you. The bottom line, running shoes that feel good, and that you can afford, offer you the best chance of enjoying your miles. For all the research and development dollars that have gone into shoe technology, there's still precious little evidence linking any shoe or show feature to a lower injury risk, Paquette says. But if you're committed to a running program, it makes sense to buy shoes that are specific to the sport and feel good on your feet. In normal times, the best thing to do is go to a local running shoe store to try on lots of options and let the knowledgeable sales reps guide you to find what feels best for you, Barnes says. Since that's unlikely to be an option for you right now, call or email your local running store instead. Some are still open for curbside shopping or delivery. A trained salesperson may be able to answer some of your basic questions and steer you toward appropriate options by phone. Some stores, such as Fleet Feet Chicago, even offer virtual fittings via Zoom. All products featured on SELF are independently selected by our editors. If you buy something through our retail links, we may earn an affiliate commission.